Welcome. Wow, so loud. I need to adjust my mic. Sorry. Is it better? Still loud? It's okay? Yes. Welcome to Stone Temple United Methodist Church. I am Idoma, the pastor here. Today is All Saints Sunday. All Saints is a day when we recognize Christians who have gone before us, and also a day of asking how we should live as saints now and how we intend to pass on the faith to the future generations of believers. So, during the worship service, may each one of us find a way of the All Saints Day meaning and experience God's love and grace. Let us prepare our mind and souls for the worship today.
Thank you. started on that day. Is today when she starts?
No. She starts, tomorrow's her first day, so she starts next Sunday, I think.
Is she nervous?
I've talked to her.
Oh, she's busy.
Others? Yes. We had a joyous celebration of all my great grandchildren's, the month, birthday.
Oh.
It was about 50 of us there.
Ooh.
Most of the time, it was very, very enjoyable.
Great.
I think we have joined, the Abby and Todd.
Yes, Abby and Todd are here, and they are here for their first Sunday as a married couple.
They're still married.
Exactly. We're very happy.
Oh, no, we got to come out now.
What did he say?
He's married to cousin mother.
We had a very successful men's night Wednesday night, and still challenged the ladies to do it. Guys are having a blast.
Yeah, we'll see what we can do about that. Come on, we'll work on that. Others? Okay, then we'll say he is born twice in preparation for our
of Jesus the Christ. You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but it is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a bushel basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to God in heaven. Beloved of God, grace and peace to you. As a constitutional republic, supported by a democratic form of government, the vote of every eligible individual in these United States of America is critical to our way of life. We enjoy the right to participate in election processes on a regular basis. There are times when that process is without note because it is so routine. Conversely, there are other times when the process creates heightened awareness and anxiety. We are in the latter time. That being the case, many people are not only participating by casting their vote, but also participating in prayer vigils, public demonstrations, marches, and other forms of prophetic witness. Now let us be sure this activity is supported by our constitutional right to the freedom of speech and our polity as United Methodists, articulated through our social principles. In fact, our founder, John Wesley, understood that we as people of faith ought to be the conscience of the nation. He and many of his contemporaries were outspoken against slavery, directing their righteous indignation both within the church and to the society at large, bearing witness to injustice in the laws, policies, and practices of our systems of government is a part of our denominational heritage. It is sacred work. And as evidenced in the scripture from the book of Matthew, we maintain a responsibility to exercise these rights in a Christ-like manner. While engaging in public discourse about the heart of our democracy can and should be a time of deep sharing, empathetic listening, and learning, it all too often devolves into arguments, divisive posturing, and sometimes even violence. This is deeply regrettable and not representative of who we are as disciples of Jesus the Christ. Many of you, like myself, have already participated in early voting. Others of you will head to the polls on Tuesday, November 3rd. I encourage everyone to vote. This is a right many other people around the world only dream of. And unlike a typical election cycle, we have been cautioned that the result of the election may not be known for some time. When the results are finalized, some will celebrate, others will lament. Some will feel vindicated while others completely ignored. May we, as the people of God, remain centered in our understanding that the eagle never flies higher than the cross, and that the outcome of any election does not change who we are called to be as salt and light. Who we are as those called to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with our God. As leaders in the Baltimore-Washington Conference, we are always called to the highest standard of engagement and interaction with our neighbors, even those with whom we may disagree. We are also called to be peacemakers, and our very presence, even in the midst of disturbances, should invoke civility and calm. Whenever possible, our voice should de-escalate situations rather than escalate them. Resources have been compiled to offer information, guidance, and recommendations for both lay and clergy to engage in acts of public and prophetic witness, opening our sacred spaces to serve as places of welcome, prayer, community resourcing, and safe haven. We encourage all those who plan to participate in such activities to read these documents carefully, plan accordingly, and commit to privileging life above every other consideration. I close with one of the prayers that we have used during our 30 days of prayer and fasting. We are praying for peace. We are praying for shalom in our nation. We are praying for a move of God in our midst. Won't you pray with me? Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light, and where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, and to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, and it is in pardoning that we are pardoned. And it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen and amen.
We have started to designate it. So each week, we designated the three families, and then we pray for. And this week, we pray for Kathy Mike Hagel, and John Chamberlain, and Caroline, and Howard Clapp. So please keep in these three families in your prayers. Actually, I talked with John Chamberlain's the son, Ron. He said he's doing good. I mean, he's doing fine physically, but as you know, he need a prayer for his dementia. So he keep asking Ronnie why and he did not visit him. So please keep him in your prayers. And also, I think, I have one more. The Diane, he asked her sister and sister, the brother-in-law, Jay and daughter. Now they are sick, so please keep them in your prayers. All right. Let us pray. As a community of faith, we lift up the names and conditions of loved ones who struggle with illness, loneliness, sorrow, depression, and hopelessness. Lord, give them your light, your strength, and your healing love and power so that they can find hope, see the light, and get relief from what they have been struggling with. Compassionate Lord, we pray for those who have been devastated by recent natural disasters, wildfires in Western, hurricane in Louisiana and Mississippi, an earthquake in Turkey. Remember those who have lost their lives so suddenly. We hold in our hearts the families forever changed by grief and loss. Bring them consolation and comfort. O generous God, we lift up the wonderful things that have happened in our lives. We praise you for the joy and the gifts in our lives. Lord, we pray for our nations and the coming elections. Guide our electoral process. Empower us to be responsible citizens with our selections and actions. Guide our leaders so that they learn your way of love, justice, and mercy, and compassion. Grant them good health and a spirit of wisdom. Open them the path of reconciliation. We give thanks to you, God, that you have heard all our prayers. Be with us and strengthen us and those whom we love. Touch all our heart with your mercy. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is from John chapter 11. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus was there weeping, and the Jews who had come along were also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, Could not he who looked in the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. Where he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the response. Let us pray. Loving God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered at this time. Bless each one of us. Open our hearts and ears so that we can take your words into our hearts. Help us experience anew the surprising joy that your presence in the world can bring us. That the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and redeemer. In your holy name I pray. Amen. Today's message is about Lazarus, who was raised from the dead. There was a man named Lazarus, who lived in Bethany with his two sisters, Mary and Martha. He became ill. Jesus received word from Mary and Martha that their brother was really ill. When Jesus heard about it, he said, Lazarus' sickness will not end in death. This has happened so that God will receive glory from this. So, even though Jesus loved Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, he stayed where he was for 2 more days. Finally, he told his disciples that he was going to Bethany, to the home of his friends. Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but now I will go and wake him up. The disciples said, Master, if he's gone to sleep, he will get a good rest and wake up feeling fine. Jesus was talking about death, but his disciples thought he was talking about taking a nap. Jesus said, Lazarus is dead, and for your sake I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go in. When Jesus
finally arrived in Bethany, Jesus found that Lazarus has already been in the tomb for 4 days. Martha went to meet Jesus and said to him, "If you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus told her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said, "Yes, I know that he will be rise again in the resurrection at the last of day." Jesus told her, "I'm the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die." Here is the Gospel of John's inscriptive message. The eternal life is not just what happens to us only after we die. It begins not any other time nor at death, but wherever and whenever anyone becomes connected with the eternal God through the living Christ in the here and now. Whoever believes in him has eternal life now. Of course, physical death will come, but Jesus' words speak to one spirit when he said, "Whoever lives by believing in me will never die." Death, physical death will come. But this is not the death that separates us from God. Jesus has the power and life to save us from eternal death and to give us eternal life through him. Those who believe in me, even though they die, but they will live, says Jesus. And then he asks Martha, "Do you believe this?" And Martha confesses her faith. "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." And Jesus validates her faith in him. And here is the climax. Jesus raises her brother Lazarus from the dead. Jesus calls in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" Jesus showed the people that death would never ever have last word over him. Also, Jesus helped them to believe that he's the Son of God who could control even death. And then Jesus ordered the people, "Unbind Lazarus and let him go." So, it was not just for Lazarus, but it is for us now. Come out, become unbound, and you are free. Even though we are Christians, we are reborn, we cannot escape from a world of doubt, disease, addiction, and death. In this life, we'll always struggle with unspoken words, unfinished visions, unmet milestones, and countless what ifs. We do so, but with Jesus' life filling and strengthening us, like Lazarus, we live with the worst part of death behind us. However, Jesus calls us in a loud voice, "Come out from what binds you and go." Dear brothers and sisters, death will never have the last word over any who have been joined to Jesus Christ's death and resurrection. Death cannot separate us from Jesus Christ. Whoever believes in Jesus has eternal life now. It starts not the end of time, nor at death, but wherever and whenever anyone becomes connected with the eternal God through the living Christ in the here and now. Eventually, what is what being a saint or being like Christ is all about. Not perfect and sinless, but lives bind to the life of Jesus Christ and live in the messy and sometimes smelly realities of our sinful and broken world. When God goes about making us God's saints, this does not protect us from grief. Instead, God binds us to God's risen Son and make us people who grieve, but we have a hope that cannot be shaken. When God makes a person one of God's saints, God does not make his or her life problem-free. Instead, God binds us to God and gives us grace and strength, not only to come out from what binds us and grow, but also to help others unbind and let them go. So, remember this. We are God's saints, and we may live eternal life through the living Christ in the here and now. Thanks be to God. It's time for the light for the candles. Those who are gone before us this year. So this time, the team is going to call their name, and then I will light the candles.
Chamberlain, Barbara Enser, Charlotte Lepo, Helen Armacost, Jim Rill, Vince Bagley, Marvin Holliger, Johnny Arbaugh, does anyone else have any names of anyone this year?
And then the another candle for those who are passed away, the before, not this year, the before the, this year, so this time we light the candle for those who are in the print in your handout. for it clear. Let us pray in silence. As we rejoice in Tiet Festival in honor of All Saints, Almighty God, your saints are one with you in the mystical body of Christ. Give us grace to follow them in all virtue and holiness until we come to those inexpressible joys which you have prepared for those who truly love you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our offering plate is in the back. In addition to the regular offering, our November mission offering is to Meals on Wheels, and the second plate for that is also in the back. That will remain there for the month of November. In addition, we're needing to offer some help to Sue in counting and depositing the offering. So after church today, we're going to have a brief tutorial in the hall to learn how to do that and what that consists of. If you are able to help us out with that, which would be when Sue is not there, so that we have some backup to support her in that. If you can do that after church today, please join us for that. If you're able to help us out, if you can't come today, we can show you how to do it really anytime. So if you're willing to help with that on occasion, please let us know and we'll plan to show you what's what, and it's not that hard to do. We have a council meeting in November on the 18th at 7, that's here. And we're going to be having an Advent Bible study starting on Thursday the 19th. So we'll have council when the next night of Bible study starts. There's a book for that. It's by Adam Hamilton. Costs $13.49. So please talk to the pastor. You don't know if you're interested in that. We've ordered poinsettias for the, what are you showing me?
It's a sign up sheet.
Oh, good, sign up for the study. And then we have ordered poinsettias for the holiday season, so if you're interested in purchasing one or two or more of those, please let Sue know.
That's
sign up sheet.
I have on the social hall on the bulletin board, like
And we did Bugs and Fishes yesterday, had a good turnout, and so that was fun. Thanks to those of you who helped. And we packed bags on Friday night. There were enough of us, it took about 5 minutes to pack those bags. So please remember, when the more of us who help, many hands make light work. Yep. Other announcements?
I think that is November, by November 14th, so you should order. And then if you put the offering plate, I will take to the Zion, so maybe that is to your convenience.
I'll put them back here in the back, you saw them here next week, so they're there, if you're interested,
take one. Please stand for the doxology.
Thank you.
us so much. Have these gifts be used for ministry of hope and healing throughout your world. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
Lift up your heart to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, God of Abraham and Sarah, God of Miriam and Moses, God of Joshua and Deborah, and God of Ruth and David, and God of priests and the prophets, and God of Mary and Joseph, and God of the apostles and the martyrs, and God of our mothers and our fathers, God of our children to all generations. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna.
Holy are you, and the blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of a new covenant, pour out for you and for many for forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered in here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. Renew our communion with all saints, especially those whom we name before you. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, strengthen us to run with perseverance to race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast in his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, mighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Body of Christ, broken for all of us. Blood of Christ shed for all of us. This is the Lord's table. We are all invited. So now you have this communion package, right? So now let's open it. And then very first, plastic lid you need to take off. And then hold wafer in your hand. And then repeat after me. The body of Christ given for me. Amen.
The body of Christ given for me. Amen.
And then eat the what? And then, secondly, you need to open it. And then hold your cup in your hand. Take your time, it's okay. All right. Repeat after me. The blood of Christ given for me. Amen. And then this one put in the Ziploc bag. Now I invite you to prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves to others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Our closing hymn is verses 1 and 4 of For All the Saints. Please stand.
Thank you.
that. Eternal life starts whenever and wherever we become connected with the eternal God through the living Christ in the here and now. And death cannot separate us from you. Let us come out from what binds us and through believing and trusting in the Lord so that we can taste of God's kingdom on earth. When peace with the power of God's love, in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Amen.